This is a long research that has been ongoing for 5 years now, since about 2007, 2008. And it started in Central Africa, where when we started to assess what was happening on the, what we call chainsaw milling, or small scale harvesting, timber harvesting. What I'm going to present to you here is the result of a team effort from CIFOR, my colleagues, the Center for International Forestry Research, Australian National University, and funded mainly by the European Union, but also by the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So the situation in the Congo Basin, for those of you who are not familiar with the area, this is the Congo Basin, and it includes mostly five countries, which is Cameroon, Central African Republic, Democratic Republic of the Congo, or DRC, Republic of the Congo, and Gabon. These are the five countries that make most of the area of forested area when we discuss about the Congo Basin. In terms of how the land is used, you see here the red dots are logging concessions, so concessions given out to logging companies, large-scale logging companies. The green polygons are protected areas. And in terms of production, the whole of the Congo Basin produces about 7-8 million cubic meters a year officially, which makes up of 3% of the tropical timber production in the world. There are two major trends that have been ongoing in the last 5 to 10 years. One is those concessions managed with management plans, and those concessions that are starting to have certification, in this case FSC certification. And the other trend, major trend, has been a kind of push from external, let's say, partners of this country, like the European Union, to sign what we call the voluntary partnership agreement. So there's been an external push to produce only legal timber from this concession. Why did we decide to set up the whole research effort? Because we found that there was a lot of timber that was not produced within those concessions, but outside by external, not industrial companies, and not mostly for export, but for the domestic market. So the major differences between the domestic market and the industrial sector, so the red polygons that I show there, is that the chainsaw miller are small scale, they don't have felling permits, techniques are mostly chainsaw, timber is sold on the domestic market, and for taxes and regulation this is mostly informal, so we also refer to it as the informal sector. And we wanted to have answers to the question, what will happen to these people when externally induced legalization effort or certification efforts impact on this specific part of the market. So the data collection, as I said, it started in 2008 and it's still ongoing, specifically in DRC. For the Congo Basin, we collect the data in these countries. Oh, sorry, I forgot Central African Republic. But we are also collecting data in Indonesia and Ecuador to have a sample from other continents. So this has been an effort that it's basically weekly data, night and day, on the roads, on the market. And you see here the number of points that we collected. As of today, I think we are at about 1,000 interviews with chainsaw millers, and about 500 market that we are following in all the countries. There's been already publication which you can download if you want to go in detail for each country. They are available on this website. So there is one for Cameroon, one for Gabon, one for the Congo, a general one, and there's the DRC and Central African Republic that are being published. But just to be sure that we are talking about the same thing, because when we present this sector abroad, people have normal different ideas of what we mean by small-scale chainsaw logging. So this is what it means. It means harvesting with no protection in the forest, where normally you don't have a logging permit, so you harvest everywhere in what we call the agroforestry domain. So a domain that is not supposed to be managed with management plan, there is no management plan there, and then you process the ROG in planks normally or other typologies of product. The timber is carried out of the forest, it's mostly 2, 3, 5 kilometers maximum on the head to the closest road, and then loaded on trucks and then sold in cities. This is specific to Cameroon. You have big market open to everybody. It's not the same in Latin America, for instance, or in Indonesia. But the end use, and of course, some of this timber, though I said that it's mostly domestic, it's also exported. This is the eastern DRC border, and you can find this timber in Johannesburg or in Mombasa or in Nairobi. So timber is also going out of the region. But not to the European Union, mostly not to European Union or to the US. And then it's used mostly domestically for construction, infrastructure, etc. So this is what it's used for. So three major findings that the research pointed out. One is that if you compare the formal production of large-scale logging concessions with management plans, certification, etc., it makes up only for about 40% of the total production of the region. The rest is what we just saw. So it's informal, small-scale chainsaw production. And this is important because this production is not recorded anywhere. When you look for statistics in the FAO, in the ITTO, everywhere, this timber does not show up. So when you look for statistics, you say, how much is the production of Cameroon, Gabon, DRC, you name it, these things does not happen. So it's not there. You don't know who is doing what. And even the countries themselves, they don't record the production of this small-scale timber. Second major finding is that these activities are a very big, important source of livelihood for rural economies. There are millions of euro that are distributed every year to rural economies. It changes, it varies between countries, but it's a big source of income. And of course, even the cost for the chainsaw millers are still costs that you see remain in the local area. So these are wages to assistant, to sawyer, fee to customer owners to buy the tree, etc. The rest remain on third-party furniture for oil, etc. There is one important thing that is not that also remain locally, but it makes a bit the governance of the sector not easy, and that are the informal taxes. So the bribes that these chainsaw loggers have to pay at each step of the chain to from the local official at the local level to official at all the levels of the chain, and this makes it very difficult to manage. And one other important thing that we found during the interviews is that when you ask when you ask chainsaw loggers what are their problems in conducting their activities, the absence of a legal title is not a problem for them. So this poses us a question of what will happen when now all this externally induced trend of legalizing, certifying, so put these people into some kind of rule, what will happen to them? Since as of today, it's not a problem for them to operate without a title. So they could be put out of the market, and etc. And this was the problem that basically forced us to ask the question, so let's see what's happening in other sector, if we can propose some kind of solution. And of course, the most important problem in all the countries is that administrative abuse of power, hassles, etc. There are a few consequences that are very important for the area where we operate, and that is this: a lot of these chainsaw loggers, they don't really care about the law anymore, because the only interaction they have with law enforcement agents is for those agents to come on the ground and ask for bribes. So every time these agents come on the ground and say, oh, there is a new law, there is the VPA, there is certification, etc., these harvesters, they are only looking for, okay, where do you want the new bribe coming from? And it's important because they don't have any more the confidence in the state, and there is a very weak legitimacy of the state to enforce any kind of law. Even if it's a good law, now they go on the ground, and these harvesters, they know that they just want some bribes. This makes the operation on the ground very, very difficult. And of course, in a perfect world, we are discussing with all these governments, and that's why we are also here to find solutions from other sectors, about what are the solutions that we can propose. So one, of course, is that where is this resource located? It's in agroforestry areas, which by default are not supposed to be managed sustainably. So what do we do in this kind of, areas? How do you manage? So what we are suggesting is probably you need to recognize these customary rights of ownership of the land, even if it's a small scale. And the rights to commercial use. As of today, none of these people has the right to commercialize timber. They can only cut for their own personal use, which is barely, it's unrealistic. It will never happen. Access to the resource is another problem. They need titles in the law that are adapted to their needs. And of course, access to the profession. As of today, if they wanted to do this legally, they have to ask logging titles as they were industrial sector manager. And it's not realistic. And again, these are the options for a perfect world. But then we all know that there is the structure of the state in most of these countries is not the perfect structure that you may expect, like from the president down, everyone answer to a good structure of the state. So we just published an article that put into perspective where these operations are happening in terms of governance, and you discover that behind this operation there is a lot of money made not only by politicians and local officials, but also by the army. Plenty of generals and colonels, they transport this timber in their own army trucks. So there is a lot to say about these efforts on legalizing everything, because the people that are supposed to put the law in place are the same people that today are making a lot of money out of this sector. And that's one of the reasons why you have resistance from the government also in implementing their own laws. And what you have at the end is this structure of the state in reality. So if you look every location on the ground, there are little fiefs that remain there managed by one or another officials that only has the interest to keep the data for him or herself without putting the data out in the open and keeping the network of corruption within themselves to get more money from this harvester. And that's the problem, because what do you do in this? What are the options for someone like the European Union or the US now with the Lacey Act to say, okay, how do we legalize these activities with this governance background? So at this point of the research, Louis had a great idea, and he said, why don't we look outside of the box? Why don't we look outside of the forest? And that's why we are here with two panels with examples of sectors that have already been formalized or at least have made important movements towards formalization. And with this, I leave the word to Louis, who is going to show you a synthesis of all the cases that we will be looking at during the day. So thank you, Louis.